Peter Grandich has published commentary on the mining and metals sector for decades now. He's currently president of Peter Grandich and Company. Welcome back, Peter Grandich.
Thank you for always having me.
We just had Ralph Acampora on the show and had some interesting comments on the precious metals as well as the commodities that I think runs contrary to a lot of bears. He's convinced that the yellow metal and silver, as well as crude oil, have most likely found their bottoms. Now, there could be retests ahead, but he thinks the lows, the nadirs, are in place.
Well, I operate under the basis that the only one that really truly knows the future is God, but we can take good stabs at it. I think pretty much online, I don't see how oil goes back or even tests the mid-20s lows. I think we've had an absolute bottom, and I think the same could be said for gold. I know that this time last year, every day you all read somewhere somebody writing the death of gold, and it was going well under 1,000 and never get back above 1,000. And it managed to put in an incredible bottom. And I don't know, in 3+ decades of being around financial markets, I don't remember any market where it was just universal bearishness and basically last one out, turn out the light. So I think clearly both gold and oil have not only bottomed, I don't see any type of retest, anything close to those lows that were made in gold, in the 1050 area, and in oil in the, the mid-20s.
Exactly. I mean, it was a remarkable sell-off. I mean, take a look at the 147 Zenith we saw 5 or 6 years ago, almost 5 years of sideways actions, and then it all just culminated with this dollar strength and broke down to, as you say, sub-30s. That seemed a bit extreme. It's good to hear that two top, Wall Street pundits are on board, at least with us, that we could have seen the bottom. Do you like the shares, or are they overbought?
I think the shares are always a different story. They always tend to, when something has bottomed, they tend to move up far more percentage-wise. I think we've seen that both in the oil stocks, the metal stocks. If we look how much oil and gold percentage-wise is off its bottom, the shares are multiples higher than that. I think in the gold area, I think there's, while they've moved up a lot, I think if one has multiple year horizons and not just a day trader, there's still a lot of room in that. I mean, people have to understand, and I was a victim of it too, of how devastation there's been from 2012 to this year in the metals and mining industry across a vast spectrum, not just metals, but base metals and steel and iron ore and all those things. And it's like battleships. They just don't turn on a dime. And I think people have been so badly beaten and bruised that even if they see the ship turning, they really won't jump back in until it's clear and evident that it's clear sailing again. So I think shares can consolidate at any period of time, but I think particularly in the metals. And they can move separately, historically at least, than what the general stock market does. I think if there was a big swoon in the general stock market, even if oil itself wasn't selling off because the oil stocks are so widely held, they could go down with that swoon. But I think I just don't know anybody who was really buying gold shares in the last few years. So I just think anybody that had to sell has done it. And that's why I think that there's still long-term, there would be a substantial room on the upside. If you believe, as I do, that gold, has a $1,400 or even $1,500 price before the end of the year in it.
We agree with you. $1,400, $1,500, we have our sights set on that target, 21 to 26, best case for silver. And we also share your thoughts on, the XAU down to lows not seen since maybe 2000, 2001. Give back all of the bull market, the 2001 to 2012 gold bull market, all of the gains that were recorded during that time, and maybe even went sub from the starting point briefly. That's virtually 100% retracement. I wonder if our listeners could imagine if the Dow Jones made a 100% retracement from the maybe 1929, 1931 low, the onset of the Great Depression. So excessive pessimism, certainly there. Just a normal retracement, a Fibonacci retracement, would take us higher. We haven't discussed the equities. We don't want to see a break of the, obviously support in the next few weeks. Otherwise, we'll have another retest of the lows we put in now and a couple of swings in the S&P and the Dow.
Well, I think the story that's not being widely discussed that's going to have a serious impact in the equity market is really the, I think, the death blow to the hedge fund industry. I think there's clear evidence that the hedge fund model is not only under assault, but it's been, I believe, terminally damaged. And if that's true, and how much hedge funds have had in the past influence on the equity markets, I think that is a net negative for the general equity market. I will argue, in hindsight, it's always 20/20 to look back, that the most important thing that propelled the equity market the last few years higher is the Fed. The second most has been hedge funds and big money using a variety of programs, some of them only related to computer algorithms and couldn't even know what the name of the company is or what it does. But those things have helped propel the market higher, and I think they're in danger or have seen their best days. And so I would suspect that if you remove that power from the equation, I don't see how giving valuations are historically high.
You know, Ralph Acampora brought up here as well. He said, look, you know, we've got political issues, concerns about the economy. Obviously, the Fed is nervous because they're not willing to raise rates. If they're not raising rates, there's concerns there by our policymakers. And of course, that could indicate less than sanguine conditions ahead for the domestic economy. A lot of wild cards and investors, not big aficionados of wild cards. Tell us what else is on the docket. Anything else, any other topicality for our listeners, please?
What surprises me to this day in the last couple of years is how little attention has been paid to how the U.S. market in general, not specific to a core, is trading and acting as the Japanese market has done since 1989. The governments are making similar moves with monetary policies, the substandard economic growth. Once a powerhouse. When people ask me, what do you think the U.S. stock market or the U.S. markets in general are going to do, I tell them, look no further than what Japan has done. And now, as you hinted that, I think eventually the Fed resorts not only to not raising interest rates, but be forced to some sort of QE4 or worse, negative interest rates. I just think we've taken many of the actions that Japan has done, and we've seen how poorly it's worked for Japan. So I just think the United States is the sequel to Japan, in my honest estimate.
Stuck in the quagmire, not a lot of forward progress. We're likely to see some big volatility ahead and nervous investors. Certainly, you're paralleling a lot of the wiser minds on Wall Street and Main Street today. You're joining the chorus that maybe all is not as well as we think with the markets. And perhaps you'd like to share any contact information or more about petergrandich.com.
Your listeners are welcome to go to Peter Grandich. That's Peter, G-R-A-N-D-I-C-H, one word, petergrandich.com. There's a Peter Speaks, that's our blog. They can just provide an email address and they can receive our comments.
Peter Grandich, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
The gold and silver mining sector is red hot. Every investment portfolio needs precious metal shares. GoldSeek.com's top stock analysts have done it again, identifying the next solid gold nugget opportunity, Brazil Resources. Based in the eighth largest economy with a mining-friendly reputation, almost 10 million ounces of gold reserves, industry insiders are accumulating shares of Brazil Resources. The notable management team includes Chairman Amir Adnani, a rising star in the mining industry with a reputation for moving projects rapidly into production. Fortune magazine lists Chairman Adnani in the prestigious list of 40 under 40 ones to watch. Plus, shareholders benefit from the insights and backing of enigmatic Brazilian billionaire Mario Garneiro, CEO of Brazil Invest Group, the nation's foremost merchant and investment bank. And founding director, their São Jorge project is 100% owned with paved highway access, a nearby workforce, and a hydroelectric power source near the major gold deposits. Their next top project includes three deposits identified by major gold producers, plus their Ria project, which is a joint venture with Areva, benefits from a $10 million treasure map in the hottest address for uranium production in Canada. But the story gets even more exciting with their Whistler project, offering geographic diversification in South Central Alaska. To find out more about this unique opportunity, please direct your web browsers to BrazilResources.com. At Yahoo Finance, ticker symbol BRI.V. Remember, to ride the exciting gold stock run of 2016 and beyond, your portfolio will thank you for adding shares of Brazil Resources.
GoldSeek employees may or may not own shares. Nothing contained herein should be construed as investment advice.